The Netherlands were in turmoil. The 17 independent states were ruled by the Lord of the Netherlands, King Felipe II of Spain. Felipe had sworn to uphold each of the state's constitutions, but he hadn't. The Lord had appointed Spanish scholars to city and state governments, which undermined the Dutch nobility. He had sent Spanish bishops to the Low Countries to hunt down and convict Protestants to be burnt at the stake as heretics. The Dutch were very angry about this. Various groups of nobles protested the king's cruel and illegal policies and tried to convince Felipe to exercise leniency and compassion. The king dismissed all of them. His drastic measures were necessary to save his subjects from hellfire. But the troubles got worse, and a revolt was brewing. The governor's general, Margarethe di Parma, who ruled in the king's stead, made an agreement with the nobles who called themselves geuzen, or beggars. She would halt the Inquisition and allow Protestant worship in selected places, and wait for her brother, King Felipe, to make a final ruling. But the moderation she offered, and the king more or less agreed to, was too little too late. On August 10, 1566, St. Laurentius Day, Sebastian Matte, a traveling hat maker, held a hedge sermon in Steenvoorde in the southern Netherlands. He preached for 2,000 Protestants. Afterwards, some members of the congregation entered the St. Laurentius Monastery. They started to tear the place apart. 40 years of suppressed anger about the Roman Catholics worshipping idols so openly, the church's obscene wealth, and the constant persecutions of the Protestants exploded in a wave of violence against church property. The statues of the saints were particular targets. News of this iconoclasm spread. Groups of Protestants soon broke into more monasteries and churches, destroying over 400 of them in Flanders alone in mere days. This was an attack on the church. No businesses or government buildings were raided. Nothing was stolen. Everything was destroyed and left behind. The government was powerless to stop it. However, in some areas, the mere presence of great nobles like Prince Willem of Orange and La Moral, the Count of Egmont, kept the rioters at bay. But the destruction moved north. And by the end of the month, when the southern states had already calmed down, the raids there got really organized. Some nobles even defended the rioters physically. In the south, most of the population still supported the church. A lot of the attacks were repelled, and the Protestant church never took hold. In fact, the Roman Catholics were very violent instead. They attacked the hedge sermons, plundered Protestant houses, and forced the rebaptism of children. But in the northern states, the Roman Catholics hardly resisted at all, even though the Protestants were greatly outnumbered. When the churches started offering the rioters money to buy off the raids, the half-starved people turned them down. That's how big their outrage was. And then, the middle classes started backing up the protests. They didn't feel very loyal to the church or the king. They were worried about the economic collapse because of Felipe's strict Roman Catholicism. And in some areas where there were no Calvinists at all, the destruction was done by the religiously undecideds of the lower classes. These riots split the compromise. To attend a forbidden sermon is one thing, but to destroy a church is a whole nother ballgame. Anyone on the fence about religious tolerance was now forced to pick a side: rebellion or loyalty. Most chose loyalty. Anything else would be treason. The Protestant ministers and the great nobles all denounced the image-breaking. Orange and Egmont felt the violence was simply too appalling and wanted no part of it. The Counts of Megen, Berlaymont, and Aremberg hit back hard against the rioters in their states. Margarethe was beside herself with rage and terrified. The beggars would come for her next. Pamphlets spread in Brussels said no bastard should be in charge of the government and called for everyone to hunt the whore down and send her back to the devil. The governor's general didn't dare tell King Felipe about the riots until a week after they started. The country was a madhouse, she said, and she warned her brother that half the population were heretics now. Over 200,000 people were taking up arms against her. Exaggerate much? Next, Margarethe ordered Orange to come to Brussels for a council meeting. The prince feared that the moment he rode out of the gates, all hell would break loose in Antwerp, but Margarethe demanded he come at once. The moment Willem left Antwerp, all hell broke loose. The wealthiest city of the Netherlands was now also hit with the fury. On August 22, 1566, at 3 o'clock in the morning, the Prince of Orange and the Counts of Egmond, Hoorn, Berlaymont, and Mechen, along with other Golden Fleece nobles, were summoned to the palace. They found Margaretha packed and ready to flee to Mons before Brussels fell into beggars' hands. The men begged her to stay. The country was a powder keg. If the mob out there saw her escape, she'd set off a civil war. Egmond swore he would drag her butt back to Brussels with 40,000 men. Hoorn swore he would protect her, even if it would cost him his life. The next day, Margaretha was still panicking. The stadtholders promised to restore order in the country, but only if she signed a new accord drafted by the Compromise of Nobles. She had to agree to stop the Inquisition and allow Protestants to preach in public, among other demands. Exasperated, Margaretha signed the accord. The nobles declared a victory. Yet, the Governor General had added some minor tweaks. The Compromise of Nobles had to disband, and Calvinism was only allowed where it was already being preached. Oh, and King Felipe had to sign off on it all. Margaretha now ordered the stadtholders to go to the worst offending cities in their respective states to negotiate some kind of truce using the accord. Three weeks after the fury began, King Felipe heard about the sacrilege. He blew a gasket. "It shall cost them dear! It shall cost them dear! I swear it by the soul of my father!" He would set these rebels straight once and for all, because that's what they were, rebels who defied the king's God-given rule and worse, God's rule itself. That night, however, the king became violently ill. Racked with fevers, he had to stay in bed for weeks, weakened by bloodletting and a boatload of medications. But he used this downtime to concoct his response. In a rare move, Felipe personally presided over the Consejo de Estado to discuss the situation. He was convinced the great nobles had started it all. They were the culprits. They would be punished. As for the rest of his subjects, he expressed that it was his intention to treat his vassals and subjects in the provinces like a good and gentle prince, not to ruin them nor to put them into servitude, but to exercise all humanity, sweetness and grace, avoiding all harshness. The Spanish council felt that King Felipe had to go to the Netherlands personally. That way, the king could summon the great nobles to appear before his throne, and he could put a stop to it all. If the nobles refused the summons and fled the country instead, they and their houses would be ruined. But it wasn't safe there now, so he should send someone ahead with an army to disarm the rebels first. Then the king could follow shortly after and kindly pardon everyone, like a medieval good cop, bad cop. But who would make for a good bad cop? The war hero, General Fernando Álvarez de Toledo y Pimentel, the Grand Duke of Alba. The man was 60 and suffering from gout, but he accepted the job. One thing though, Alba was not known for humanity, sweetness and grace, and harshness was his middle name. And not everyone in the Spanish government agreed with the plan. Ruy de Gómez, Prince of Éboli, and the Duke of Feria, one of Spain's most prominent ministers, resisted. They felt it was a bad idea for a king to add on to a country's problems and declare war on his subjects. General Alba and Cardinal Antoine Pernod de Granvelle warned the king that the Protestants had undermined the true faith and the royal authority. They were capable of anything now. The revolt had to be suppressed. It was legal, it was appropriate, it was necessary. But Éboli wondered, was it really a good idea to send someone as hateful and hated as Alba to do the job? Most of the Spanish council wanted the former governor-general for the Netherlands, the French Duke of Savoy, to go. Or else the Italian, Ottavio Farnese, the Duke of Parma and Piacenza, Margareta's husband. The war council wanted Prince Éboli to go. King Felipe wanted Alba. He would go to the Netherlands himself next spring. The Baron of Montigny cried out that that was too late, he had to go immediately. Felipe told him that he had other things on his plate. The Baron shouted at him that there would always be other things on his plate. The king's face turned red. No one made the king's face turn red. Oh yeah, Montigny was done for. The stadtholders spent months trying to restore order. They made all kinds of deals with the Protestants using the new accord. Egmond, disillusioned by everything, didn't go easy on the rioters and summarily executed dozens of them. Orange urged him to be more merciful, but Egmond wouldn't listen and raged like a proper inquisitor. Hoorne was sent to Tournaisy, his brother, the Baron of Montigny, stadtholder it, and also let it rip. In his own states, Willem managed to get Amsterdam and Holland back under Roman Catholic control, but arranged for the hedge sermons to continue outside the town. When the local clergy told the prince that this was unacceptable and they would rather quit, the prince told them, "There's the door." Gradually, peace was restored in the Low Countries. Except now large, violent gangs of beggars started terrorizing the land, leaving a path of destruction in their wake. Forest beggars roamed the countryside, and sea beggars swarmed the rivers and attacked harbor towns. Then Margarethe found a big check in the mail from King Felipe to deal with them. She now had money, weapons, and troops, and felt more and more secure. Willem of Orange felt less and less secure. He had no money, no weapons, and no troops. The Calvinists were more than ready to pay Orange, but he, as a Roman Catholic, didn't want to be openly associated with them. On December 1st, news reached the Netherlands that General Alba was coming with an army of tercios, highly trained royal troops. Oh crap. Many historians consider Alba to be the most effective general of his time. The Netherlands had a thing coming their way. A few days later, Margarethe felt safe enough to renege on the accord. Every single one of the promises she had made to the nobles was broken, and the Inquisition was back on. Time to deal with the troublesome cities and their even more troublesome citizens. The city of Valenciennes in the state of Hainaut had ancient rites as a refuge for debtors, outlaws, and even murderers. But then the heretics moved in, and that was too much for the Dutch government. Now that she had money and troops, Margarethe ordered Philippe, Lord of Noirkem, to take troops inside and clean up the place. Hainaut's stadtholder, the Marquis of Bergen op Zoom, was still in Spain with the Baron of Montigny, the stadtholder of the neighboring state of Tournaisy. The city wouldn't let Noirkem in. Alright, that's it. The next day, on December 7th, Margarethe declared Valenciennes in a state of siege. All its inhabitants were now rebels. Noirkem invested the city with all the troops he could spare, but he couldn't completely surround the town, so the citizens were able to break out and they plundered nearby monasteries for supplies. They used the broken statues of the dismantled churches to build a bridge across the arm of a river which they mockingly called the Bridge of Idols. Because Noirkem and the six commanders under him did little to stop them, they started calling them the Seven Sleepers. Prince Willem encouraged the Valenciennes citizens to hold out. They had every right to refuse the government troops. Then two large beggar groups started gathering in the area. One disorderly and badly armed group of 3,000 at Lannoy. Another equally disorderly and badly armed group of 1,200 gathered at Waterloo. They were gonna join up and relieve Valenciennes. 2 weeks later, Margarethe ordered Noirkem to swing by the city of Tournai to install a royal garrison there. The Count of Hoorne had been recalled, but he had allowed Protestant worship in the clothiers' hall. The seigneur gave the town 90 minutes to surrender. If they didn't, he'd burn Tournai to ash and kill everyone inside. The city surrendered and accepted the garrison. See? It's not that hard. On his way back to Valenciennes, Noirkem decided to deal with the rebel armies. He attacked the beggars at Lannoy, while Seigneur de Racinghem struck the force gathered at Waterloo. The Lannoy group dropped their weapons and ran the moment Noirkem's troops came into view. At least 1,000 were killed on the spot. Another group was hunted into the river and drowned. In all, 2,600 rebels were exterminated in an hour. Racinghem attacked the Waterloo beggar army. In no time, half of them were dead or on the run. The other half had seen some service and took up position behind the wall of the cemetery. The 600 beggars kept Rassingham's troops at bay for a while, but this fort wouldn't last. The rebels retreated into the church, taking heavy fire. 400 didn't make it. The remaining 200 were hunted up the church tower all the way to the belfry. The tower was set on fire, and all were roasted alive or suffocated. No one escaped. The first shots in the rebellion had been fired. Noirkem returned to the siege of Valenciennes. He was going to starve the city out. To keep his soldiers from getting bored, he allowed them to commit unspeakable atrocities on the villages in the neighborhood. No more Seven Sleepers. They were wide awake now. The king now ordered all royal functionaries, from the stadtholders down to the army officers, to take a new oath of allegiance. They had to pledge to serve His Majesty, obey the government's orders, everywhere and against every person without limitation or restriction, and anyone who refused to take the oath would be fired on the spot and declared a rebel. This oath went much further than the old one. So far, the great nobles had always been safe from persecution. Some of them, like Willem of Orange, were married to heretics, but unless they caused problems, they were pretty much left alone. But that was over. Nearly everyone pledged to the new oath, including Hoorne and, after a little wavering, Egmond. The Prince of Orange, however, refused, categorically. He said he took his oath very seriously and only needed to make it once. All he had done was try to keep peace and order, which is what he had sworn to do. Should he now betray his conscience by taking a new oath and denouncing the old one? Did the king want him to vow to kill his wife because she was a Lutheran? Was he, a prince, supposed to take orders from General Alba, a Grand Duke? Margarethe could have his offices. Willem was done serving this awful government and wouldn't work for a king who was so distrustful that he needed a second oath from him. You want to call me a rebel? Fine, I rebel. Margarethe didn't accept his resignation. She couldn't. The prince was far too powerful, and she desperately needed him around to keep everyone else in check. All the nobles kept telling Orange to stop his one-man rebellion and give up the fight. It was no use. They had lost. Alba was coming. He was bringing an army. If the prince resisted it, he'd be committing treason. Take the oath, join them, join the loyal royal party. They had cookies. Willem did not take the oath. The prince wanted to fight and even had strategy meetings with the grand beggar Hendrik of Brederode and the Count of Hoorne. They would attack the cities in Brabant from different directions and quickly occupy Zeeland and Antwerp, so Margarethe could not receive supplies and troops from Spain. The Germans would stop new Spanish forces from crossing the eastern border. But the men had no money and no troops, and in the end, Germany chickened out. Brederode, impatient as ever, raised a few troops and tried to seize Amsterdam, but Willem was afraid to make the governor's general angry and frustrated his plans. Margarethe was confused about what the prince was trying to do, and wrote Felipe that she couldn't understand his motives. Well, Orange was trying to do two diametrically opposed things. Keep Brederode and his compromise, who wanted violence, happy, and keep the southern nobles, who hated the Protestant rebellion, happy. This duality could not last. Willem had to choose, armed resistance or submit. He hesitated. Orange couldn't get any of the grandees, least of all Egmond, to join him. Sure, the Count believed the Inquisition had way too much power, but that wasn't reason enough to rebel. And the Protestants were an untrustworthy lot. The prince eventually backed down and returned to Antwerp. Among the citizens, however, a determined Protestant opposition remained. You could say that the 80 Years' War started at the Siege of Valenciennes or the battles of Lannoy and Waterloo. You could say that. No one else is saying that. The prince was the only one in the country who could officially declare war, and he hadn't yet. It was still a rebellion. Historians decided that the war started in 1568, but in the peace treaty of Münster, they marked the year 1567 as the beginning of the war, perhaps because that's when Alba arrived and the king had basically declared war on his own people. But maybe they considered the Battle of Oosterweel the start of it all. In February 1567 in Antwerp, Jan van Marnix, Lord of Toulouse, was raring to go with an army and invade Zeeland. Prince Willem forbade him to go. Toulouse was just a boy, with plenty of courage but no experience in leading troops. His men were untrained vagabonds and outlaws. Toulouse went anyway and, as Orange predicted, got nowhere. He didn't want to return to Antwerp with his tail tucked between his legs, so Toulouse set up camp at Oosterweel, just a mile north of Antwerp. It was an excellent strategic position because it was surrounded by dikes on three sides. The young commander quickly fortified the area. Rebels from all over the country knew that Oosterweel was the place to be, and soon Toulouse had 3,000 men under his command. Brederode, who hadn't taken the new oath either, had been gathering 6,000 troops in Holland. Together, these men would march to relieve Valenciennes. A few weeks later, at daybreak, a couple of guards of Toulouse's camp saw soldiers coming. They approached the troops unarmed, thinking they were Brederode's men. They weren't. The flags unfurled to reveal the whopping big burgundy crosses, and the war drum started beating. It was the Lord of Beauvoir, captain of Margarethe's bodyguards. He had snuck up on the beggars with 800 tercios, highly trained BAMFs. Oh crap. The beggars raced back to camp, scrambled for their weapons, while Toulouse positioned his men. They had the advantage, but at 9 a.m., Beauvoir's veteran soldiers broke the rebel defenses in a single charge. It was not a fight, it was a hunt. In under an hour, hundreds lay dead in the camp, hundreds drowned in the river, and hundreds hid in two farmhouses that Beauvoir's men set on fire, killing everyone inside. The government troops chased the beggars for 3 miles and killed nearly 3,000 in just a few hours. Toulouse lay dead in the field. Everyone in Antwerp had been watching the drama unfold from their city walls. Willem had kept the gates shut to prevent anyone from leaving the town and join the slaughter fest. But 10,000 armed Calvinist citizens, rallied by Toulouse's widow, wanted to fight Beauvoir and go. At noon, the prince mounted his horse and tried to talk him off the ledge. The people cussed him out. "Now you want to be with us? You should have been here earlier and made sure that those in Oosterweel were not defeated. You should have let them into the town." One man leveled a gun at Willem's chest, calling him a traitor. Orange told him, "If you really mean that, you should pull the trigger." Someone slapped the gun away. Willem explained, "The battle was over. The rebels were dead. What were they gonna do against a professionally trained army? It would be a bloodbath. And what if they were pushed back into the town? Did they want the Spanish troops to enter Antwerp?" Most people went away, but 500 of the most violent demanded to leave. Willem was like, "Fine, open the gate and have at it." The tercios were all over the place, still hunting down rebels. But when Beauvoir heard a noise coming from the city, he quickly pulled together a company and prepared for an assault. However, they had 300 prisoners of war that they intended to ransom for a bit of cash. 800 men controlling 300 men while fending off an attack was unwise. So Beauvoir ordered every one of the prisoners of war shot. He then marched toward the Calvinists, who didn't know how fast to run back to the city's safety. Beauvoir rode right up to the city walls and planted Toulouse's captured banners on the edge of the moat, daring those in Antwerp to come and fight him. No one took the bait, so the captain took his trophies and left. The Battle of Oosterweel was done, but the battle inside Antwerp was only just beginning. Meanwhile, about 15,000 Calvinists had barricaded themselves in the streets of Antwerp. They had raided the town's arsenal and had even set up 16 cannons. They were furious with Willem's inaction and threatened to destroy the churches and sack the houses of Catholics. While they were at it, Lutheran homes as well. All night and all day, Orange worked with all the city leaders to hammer out some kind of peace agreement and avoid a war. Among other things, the deal allowed the Protestants free worship inside the town. To make sure the Calvinists would accept it, he got the Lutherans, Roman Catholics, and foreign mercantile associations to form their own, bigger army. The next day, the prince rode right up to the Calvinist cannons and told the crowd to stand down. A fight was hopeless. They were outnumbered 2-1. Moments later, it was done. The peace accepted, the battle averted, Antwerp saved, and no one got hurt. However, Margarethe couldn't appreciate the prince's efforts at Antwerp and denounced his unholy deal. Sure, he had just saved the largest and wealthiest city from destruction, but he had given the right of worship to Calvinists and Lutherans, and King Felipe would not abide. Meanwhile, at Valenciennes, Noirquem gleefully told the citizens about the loss at Oosterweel. They refused to believe it. Then, with Egmont's enthusiastic help, Noirquem set up cannons and opened the batteries on the town. He shelled the city for 24 hours straight. People were not in immediate danger, but they got scared when the roof tiles and chimneys started crashing all around them, and from the cannonballs, constant percussions hitting the walls. They surrendered. But they begged that the city would not be sacked and the citizens' lives would be spared. Noirquem promised, and on heart. He technically kept his promise. His soldiers didn't plunder the town, but they were quartered with the people, and they stole everything. And then the men murdered them, at their pleasure. Then Noirquem started burning Protestants at the stake. Hundreds ended up dead anyway. He wrote to Granvelle, "The capture of Valenciennes has worked a miracle. The other cities all come forth to meet me, putting a rope around their own necks. Margarethe had warned her brother many times that she suspected that the great nobles spent a lot of money intercepting their correspondence. The king needed to be careful. Felipe assured her that he kept his most confidential letters in a lockbox and slept with the key. But the Prince of Orange had bought off the king's private secretary, Van der Nesse, to sneak into his bedroom, take the key, and have a look-see in that very box. Willem was fully briefed. He was sure he had to get out of Dodge. Egmont tried to talk him out of it. They were safe. After all, they were Roman Catholics. They had had nothing to do with the iconoclastic fury, and they had all fought side by side with Alba in the French-Habsburg War. It was gonna be just fine. Willem begged to differ. Felipe had ordered Alba to do three things: exterminate heresy, instate the king's absolute rule, and kill the trio. What trio? Orange, Egmont, and Hoorn. Of course. The prince was unable to convince Egmont of this information. The count was convinced it was all fake news and believed Felipe to be merciful and that he would recognize their contributions in restoring the peace. Egmont accused Willem of fleeing the country, but the prince considered it a tactical retreat. Of the great nobles, only he and Antoine de Lalaing, the count of Hoogstraten, had refused to take the new oath. With them gone, Felipe might consider the Netherlands obedient again and go easy on the rebels. Orange and Egmont held each other in a tearful embrace and said their farewells. Willem quickly prepared to leave for his family's castle at Dillenburg, Germany, out of Felipe's reach. The king wouldn't dream of invading his cousin's empire just to get at him, a German citizen. Orange said his goodbyes to his 12-year-old son, Philips Willem, who would continue his studies at Leuven University. He would be protected there because of the privileges of the school that Felipe had sworn to uphold. No student or teacher could be removed from the place by anyone except the principal. At the end of April, the prince packed up his stuff, his pregnant wife, Anna of Saxony, his daughters, Maria and Anna, and headed for Dillenburg. He arrived safe and sound 2 weeks later. Orange wrote Felipe that he still considered himself your vassal and very humble servant. Many nobles, including Brederode and Hoogstraten, also left. Remember the Marquis of Bergen-op-Zoom and the Baron of Montigny, who were still in Spain? Well, the Marquis had fallen severely ill right after Alba's fleet left from Cartagena and died under suspicious circumstances. The Baron of Montigny wanted to go home, but the king wouldn't give him permission to leave. He wasn't a prisoner, but something fishy was going on. He once rode to the next village over, and he suddenly found himself surrounded by 40 soldiers who escorted him back. Montigny was like, "Dude, if I'm a prisoner, lock me up already." King Felipe was all smiles. "You aren't a prisoner, heavens no. But I'd be so sad if you left. Stay a little longer. The Baron should accompany him on his trip to the Netherlands." Margarethe told Felipe that the troubles were now over. With the culprits gone, the problem was gone. She was now surrounded only by loyal men who had all taken the new oath. There was really no need for Alba anymore. Please, please don't send Alba. But the Duke was just about ready to cross the Alps with his army of Tertios of Lombardy, Naples, Sicily, and Sardinia. He would pick up German mercenaries underway. The Grand Duke of Alba had to force the Spanification of the Netherlands, the country's only salvation from hellfire. But the man had no talent or experience as a statesman. Alba felt that running a country was the same as running the military. Besides, he came as a conqueror, not as a mediator. "I have tamed people of iron in my day. Shall I not easily crush these men of butter?" The Duke arrived in the Netherlands with 12,000 foot and over 6,000 horse in August 1567. The men were very dissatisfied to see the country so calm. They had left Italy for this snooze fest. On his way to Brussels, Alba swung by Leuven and checked in on Orange's son. The boy's staff feared for Philips Willem's safety. But Alba gave the teen a big hug, told him that he cared deeply for him, and if there was anything he needed, anything at all, he should just ask. Alba entered Brussels with only his bodyguards and nobles, but there was no welcome party here at all. In fact, when he tried to enter the palace to talk to the governess general, her guards wouldn't let his guards pass, and even got into a fight. Margarethe had no idea what Alba's instructions were and feared the worst. Alba explained that all he had to do was to make sure the king would find the country peaceful upon his arrival. That's what his paper said. But what the king had told Alba in private, he kept to himself. The general deployed garrisons in all major cities and forced the towns to build citadels to protect the people. The Netherlands was now under martial law, and half its population was condemned to death by Pope and King. With Alba's arrival, resistance against the Spanish bishops ceased, and they were now installed at an alarming rate. Iffy principals and teachers were replaced with fiery Roman Catholic ones. Alba settled in, and people waited with bated breath. The great nobles relaxed. See? Orange had been wrong. They were fine. Grand Preceptor of the Order of Malta, Don Ferdinando, held a banquet in Brussels. He had invited Egmond, Hoorne, Noachem, and other nobles. Don Ferdinando was Alba's illegitimate son. At this dinner, someone whispered to Egmond to get the hell out of there and run. Egmond freaked out, but Noachem assured him that he would be fine. Besides, if he ran now, he'd look guilty. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Alba asked the dinner guests if they would be so kind as to come to his house to talk about the citadel he planned to build at Antwerp. At the Duke's house, engineer Pietro Urbino unrolled the building schematics for the citadel on the table. While everyone was debating the best way to go about it, Alba excused himself for a moment and left the room. The meeting ended, and everyone started to leave. Don Sancho Dávila, captain of Alba's guard, asked Egmond to stay a moment. Once everyone was gone, he said, "Egmond, your sword, please." The count was too stunned to speak. Dávila again asked, "Egmond, hand over your sword. You are under arrest." When Spanish soldiers appeared in the doorway, Egmond knew it was over. In the courtyard, Captain Salinas arrested Hoorne just as he was leaving. Both counts were now prisoners at Alba's house. The men stood accused of lese majesty, to do wrong to the king, a form of high treason, punishable by death. These leaders of men had openly protested the Inquisition, and that was bad. More men were arrested that same day, and it kicked off a wave of arrests everywhere. A bomb went off in the country. How could the Duke arrest Egmond and Hoorne, of all people? They were Knights of the Golden Fleece, there were rules for that. Margareta was also mad about the arrests. Not that they were made, but that Alba never told her about it. She was done. She was out. She resigned. King Felipe accepted her resignation reluctantly a few months later, and she could leave for Italy. Alba would become the new Governor General for the Low Countries. Felipe was over the moon that the League's grandees had all been arrested. Cardinal Granvelle, however, was less than thrilled. Orange had escaped, and he warned, "If you don't have the prince, you have no one." And Inquisitor Peter Tittelmans, hearing Willem had gotten away, said, "Then will our joy be but brief. Woe unto us for the wrath to come from Germany." Before King Felipe could visit the Netherlands, all those who had opposed the king's government in any way, shape, or form had to be arrested, tried, and executed. Because, as General Alba saw it, hombres muertos no hacen guerra. Dead men don't wage war. Alba had invented a brand spanking new court to try the rebels for high treason and appointed its judges himself. This Tribunal de los Tumultos was placed above all other courts and basically suspended the government. This was some next-level Inquisition crap, and in blatant disregard of the existing rights, privileges, and constitutions of every state. But Alba was like, "I don't give a rat's behind about your rights, privileges, and constitutions. They were granted to you by your legal sovereign. You rebelled against your legal sovereign. Everyone is cancelled, and you deserve it." Within 3 months, the council had tried and executed 1,800 mostly wealthy people who also had their properties confiscated. With 11,000 more cases to be investigated, the people started calling this Council of Troubles the Blood Council. The Duke ran into logistical problems. There weren't enough executioners or execution sites to handle the steady stream of convicts. To save time, Alba decided that people should be executed in batches and wherever possible, in doorways, orchards, and on stakes right in the streets. The court's speed was dizzying, sometimes faster than light. At one time, a man was called to the stand who had already been executed. It turned out he was actually innocent, but the judges figured he'd be adequately rewarded in heaven. In Spain, King Felipe was inundated with protest letters concerning the arrests of the Counts of Egmont and Hoorn. He never answered any of them and told Albert to speed up their trial so people could hear the truth and calm the frack down. Egmont and Hoorn were brought before the Blood Council, given a sham trial, and, surprise, surprise, found guilty on all charges. They were locked up in Ghent, and all their property was confiscated. Prince Willem received his summons to appear before the Blood Council in January 1568. As the rebellion's de facto leader, he stood accused of a whole list of treasonous acts. He had plotted to overthrow Felipe and conspired to seize power in the Netherlands. He had also encouraged heresy by allowing the Protestants in Antwerp and other cities the right to worship. Willem's response was short and sweet. As a Knight of the Golden Fleece, a member of the Germanic Empire, a sovereign prince in France, and a citizen of the Netherlands, he rejected the authority of Alba and his invented tribunal. He would gladly prove his innocence either before his emperor or before the king and six fleece knights. Them's the rules. None of the other refugee nobles showed up in court either, and a lot of them were tried in absentia and declared guilty. All their property was confiscated. Meanwhile, in Spain, King Felipe's son and heir, Don Carlos, had suffered a traumatic brain injury, and his erratic, strange, and often violent behavior was becoming a bigger problem for the king. Felipe had stripped him of all authority, but he was still not willing to give up on his son completely. The Infanta was betrothed to his cousin, Anna de Austria, the daughter of the Habsburg Emperor Maximilian, and his aunt, Maria. After he saw Anna's portrait, Don Carlos became obsessed with the pending marriage. He bought German books and objects and started to learn German. This was weird because Anna was fluent in Spanish because of her mom, his father's sister. Don Carlos was desperate to meet her. The Infanta wanted to imitate his grandfather's romantic tales by sneaking out of the country to demand the emperor to give him his daughter's hand in person. In January 1568, he shared his plot with his uncle Don Juan de Austria, the illegitimate half-brother of King Felipe and captain general of the Spanish fleet. Don Carlos begged his uncle to give him a boat for his adventure, but Don Juan told Felipe about the plans. There was no way the king was going to allow his son to leave the country, ever. The Infanta was furious at his uncle's betrayal. He loaded his arquebus, called Don Juan to his room, and then shot at him. But one of the servants, aware of Don Carlos's madness, had unloaded the gun when he wasn't looking. The Infanta, livid to realize his plan had failed, pulled a dagger to stab his uncle to death. But the general was much stronger and pushed him off. Don Carlos's behavior had gotten entirely out of control, and Felipe realized he could not heal his son. On January 18th, 1568, at 11 o'clock at night, the king put on some armor, called for his four most trusted nobles, and a few courtiers armed with hammers and nails. In total darkness, Felipe led the group through the Alcazar to Don Carlos's bedroom. He found the prince sound asleep. Felipe grabbed his son's sword and the loaded arquebus that he kept by the bed. Don Carlos woke up and panicked when he saw his father all armored up standing over him. "Are you gonna kill me or arrest me?" "Neither." Courtiers started to nail the window shut. The crown prince was placed under permanent house arrest, like his insane grandmother, Johanna. Don Carlos jumped out of bed and lunged at the fireplace to kill himself in the fire, but his servant held him back. Fuming with rage, the Infanta shouted at his father, "Are you going to restrain me like a lunatic? I'm not a lunatic, I'm just scared." Felipe told him to calm down and go back to bed. It was for his own good. People the world over were shocked. The king didn't explain his actions to anyone. All he said was that he had acted in the country's best interests and that his son was locked up because of his natural temperament, not for any crimes. At the court, no one was allowed to speak about the Infanta as though he were dead. King Felipe was bummed that the Prince of Orange was safely tucked away in Germany, plotting who knows what. Had the king been in the country and summoned the prince to come before his throne, it would be over. If Orange didn't come, his house would cease to exist. If Orange did come, he would have been arrested. Win-win. But the king couldn't leave Spain. Stuff just kept getting in the way, as Montigny told him they would. Time for Plan B. To neutralize the prince, Felipe told Alba to set a plan in motion that they had agreed on months earlier. On St. Valentine's Day, 1568, Alba's secretary, Lord of Chassé, arrived at the University of Leuven with 4 noblemen and 12 heavily armed guards. He handed one of the students there a letter from the Governor General. The letter said that the young man had 2 days to pack his things as he was being shipped off to Spain, where his loving and caring godfather would raise him the right way. The godfather was King Felipe. The student was Philips Willem, the Prince of Orange's son and heir. The 13-year-old was startled and began to cry. The teen was assured that he wasn't under arrest nor a prisoner. The guards were only there to make sure he didn't escape. So, prisoner? This was all for his own good. Philips Willem would be able to serve the king as his ancestors had done. Plus, he would get a better education at the University of Alcalá de Henares near Madrid. Of course, the boy wasn't told the real reason for his relocation. The king wanted to keep Philips Willem as a hostage in case Orange tried anything stupid. He had done the same with the eldest son of the Duke of Parma and his sister Margarete. The Duke had been giving him problems, and his son Alessandro Farnese had been raised in Madrid under Felipe's watchful eye. The Duke had behaved. The prince would not. Spoilers. The whole place was in an uproar. The principal, the school board, even the city of Leuven got involved in trying to stop the abduction, which was in clear violation of the school's privileges. It was no use. Orange's son was sent to Spain, where he was welcomed by dear old Uncle Felipe with open arms. Prince Willem wrote a letter of protest to Alba, to no avail. Months later, Philips Willem wrote a letter to his professor Valerius at Leuven University, of all people. The Royal Majesty and nearly the entire court welcomed me. You can hardly believe how happy I am. You can just feel Felipe breathing down the boy's neck while he was writing that one. Willem was devastated. But just a few months earlier, Willem's second wife, Anna of Saxony, had given birth to a son, the second one named Moritz after her dad. The first Mauritz had died a year before, at 15 months old, but this Mauritz would grow up to open a can of whoop-ass on the Spanish. Spoilers. The boy was baptized in a Lutheran ceremony, however, not a Roman Catholic one. Stuck at Dillenburg Castle, with his properties confiscated, abandoned by his fellow noblemen, his heir imprisoned in Spain, his buddies locked up, the Spanish taking over the Dutch government, half the country condemned to death, and receiving daily requests to come to the rebels' aid, Prince Willem had to act. The prince traveled all over Germany to get support, money, and troops from the German princes. He sold jewelry and silverware to fund an army. Dillenburg Castle was pretty much stripped bare, much to Anna's dismay, who had hated the already austere place. Still, she supported her husband's efforts and helped him to raise money. But her family was not forthcoming. Everyone in Germany wanted to wait and see what the Emperor would do. August of Saxony told him stille zu sitzen, and Emperor Maximilian swore Orange would be in a world of trouble if he raised an army and invaded the Netherlands. Still, the prince made plans for a 3-pronged military invasion with his younger brother Ludwig von Nassau, the Count of Hoogstraten, and François de Coqueville, a Normandy noble. If all went well, he would follow soon after. The Emperor can suck it. The Coqueville besieged Saint-Valery, but Alba, sly as ever, convinced the French king to arrest de Coqueville and have him beheaded as a highwayman. One down, two to go. The Count of Hoogstraten had fallen ill, so Jean de Montigny, Lord of Villers, led the second invasion instead. Villers crossed the border at Maastricht and tried to take Roermond. He failed and headed toward Erkenlens. The Duke of Alba sicked his 2 bloodhounds on him, Don Sancho de Londoño and Don Sancho d'Avila. Villers lost a lot of men trying to fight them off. He was forced to retreat to Dahlem with his remaining men. D'Avila and his troops had gotten lost in the fog and Londoño was outnumbered 2-1, but he was unable to restrain his men. Half an hour later, the rebel defenses were breached and nearly every beggar was killed. Villers was captured and he was tortured to give up the prince's plans. At the same time, Lodewijk had invaded the north of the country carrying a banner that read Nunc aut nunquam, recuperare aut mori. Now or never, recover or die. On April 22, 1568, Lodewijk's mercenary army of a whopping 60 men entered Groningen unopposed and picked up some cities along the way. He could do this because Groningen stadtholder Jean de Lange, the Count of Aremberg, was in France and unable to defend the state. But Alba recalled Aremberg quickly and sent him on his way. Charles de Brimeux, the Count of Megen, stadtholder of Gelderland, would join him. Lodewijk tried to convince the city of Groningen to join the rebellion. If he controlled that town, he controlled the state. Groningen refused. They feared Alba, and after what had happened at Dahlem, they had little faith that these beggars could keep them safe from his wrath. Instead, they gave Lodewijk some money to buy off an attack. The Count used it to hire more troops. More and more soldiers arrived in the rebel camps, including survivors of the Dahlem massacre. And a third Nassau brother, Count Adolf von Nassau, showed up with 300 cavalry. Aremberg and Megen met up in Zutphen to have a strategy meeting. They had no idea how large the rebel army was and asked Alba for more troops, just to be sure. The Duke sent Don Gonzalo de Bracamonte with 10 squadrons of Sardinia Tercios to Amsterdam to sail across in secret. With Aremberg and Megen closing in, Lodewijk knew that staying put would mean certain death, so he and his commanders decided to retreat that night. But the troops didn't want to go until they got paid. Lodewijk told them, fine, stay. The royal troops would find and kill them. The rebel army headed out and arrived in Winschoten the following afternoon. On May 23, 1568, while Lodewijk's troops were resting in Winschoten, the Count and his commanders were having dinner at the Mount Sinai nunnery in Heiligelee. A farmer rushed in to warn them that Aremberg had force-marched his army of 2,500. He was right on his heels. Lodewijk had to make a stand, or risk being attacked in the back. His army was rested, Aremberg's was not. He would make a stand. Lodewijk positioned his foot soldiers on the hill, flanked by his cavalry. He put Walloon gunmen in peat ditches that ran across the marshy landscape. When Aremberg arrived, he realized that Lodewijk had the advantage and decided to wait for Megen and his army of 6,000. Megen had been delayed because his unpaid soldiers refused to move until their salaries arrived from Brussels. He was at Coevorden now, about 50 miles away, and told Aremberg he would catch up with him the next day. Bracamonte's Tercios weren't having it. Standing down when glory was so obviously within reach was a disgrace. Bracamonte was like, bawk, 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 bawk. Aremberg was like, I ain't no chicken. So, at 6 o'clock at night, Aremberg positioned his cannons and started firing at Lodewijk's troops on the hills. The Count ordered his men to fall back, and Aremberg ordered the attack on the retreating army. But the rebels' retreat was not a retreat, but a tactical maneuver. Aremberg realized too late that the rebels had lured his men into a marshland. Bracamonte's men got stuck in the mud, and then they were mowed down by the sharpshooters from the ditches. Others were in such disarray that the rebel pikemen drove them off quickly. Aremberg then gathered his nobles and attacked the small rebel cavalry standing on the road, Adolf's men. The Count killed Adolf and two riders personally. But that was all the damage they could do. The rebel arquebusiers had overtaken the Spanish cannons and killed everyone in sight. No mercy for anyone. In 2 hours, it was over. Lodewijk had won. Aremberg had remained in the field until the very end. But when he ran, his horse failed to clear a fence and the Count was attacked by Martin, a rebel soldier. Aremberg pleaded for his life. He could fetch a nice ransom as a prisoner. After Martin robbed him, he stabbed him in the leg with his sword, and the Count bled to death. This went against all protocol and honor. The rebels lost about 50 men. The Spanish lost about 1,700. Lodewijk also captured a bunch of cannons and the treasury. This was the rebels' first proper victory in the field. They had proven that the great Spanish army wasn't invincible. Well, a section of it wasn't. Megen rounded up the fleeing royal troops, but because he didn't know how large Lodewijk's army was, he decided not to attack and headed to the city of Groningen instead. When Governor General Alba heard about the defeat at Heiligelee and Aremberg's dishonorable death, he fumed that he would take to the field himself to destroy the Nassau maverick. He was gonna bring all the Tercios. But 3,000 of those were guarding the Count of Egmond to prevent anyone from breaking him out of prison. On the 3rd of June, 1568, the Duke put up a scaffold at the Brussels horse market, and 80 nobles convicted by the Blood Council were led out in front of a horrified crowd. 11 were beheaded and 7 were hanged. The blood-soaked scaffold remained overnight. Alba was not done. The next day, more nobles were executed, among them Commander Villers, who had been captured at Dahlem. The Duke now placed a scaffold on Brussels' main square and announced that the Counts of Egmond and Hoorn had been sentenced to death. Everyone was in total shock, but none were more stunned than the Counts themselves, who had held out hopes for a pardon. Egmond quickly wrote a letter to the King persisting in his innocence. He signed it, "Prepare to die on June 5th, Your Majesty's very humble and loyal vassal and servant, La Morale van Egmond." On June 5th, 3,000 Spanish soldiers stood in battle array in front of the scaffold. At 11 o'clock in the morning, Egmond was led out to the platform. He proclaimed his innocence and expressed regret that he hadn't died in battle. He knelt on a velvet pillow and pulled a cap over his head. The executioner cut off Egmond's head in a single blow. FYI, they didn't use chopping blocks at this time in the Netherlands. It was freestyle horizontal sword swinging. A few minutes later, Hoorn was brought out. He spoke a few words, knelt on a velvet pillow, pulled the cap over his eyes, and his head rolled. The Duke ordered the heads of the two counts to be displayed on copper stakes for 2 hours. People far and wide were absolutely disgusted with Alba, which surprised the Governor General. Didn't they realize these men were traitors? Alba wrote Felipe that it was important that they publish general pardons, forgiving all those who had participated in the riots. As long as they ruled with blood, he argued, his subjects wouldn't love their lord. 220 years later, German author Johann Wolfgang von Goethe wrote the play Egmond as a memoriam. 20 years after that, Ludwig van Beethoven composed the accompanying music. You may have heard of the Egmond Overture. Back in 1567, when Felipe found out that the Duke had arrested Egmond and Hoorn, the King had the Baron of Montigny arrested and locked up at the Alcazar of Segovia. The Baron was unaware of anything that was happening in the Netherlands after Alba arrived. 8 men-at-arms were specifically employed to watch over him and to prevent his escape. Then one day, from his prison, the Baron heard pilgrims passing through the streets by the castle. They were singing a low, monotonous hymn, as pilgrims did. But they were singing in Dutch. It was a secret message. They told him that his brother, the Count of Hoorn, had been beheaded with the Count of Egmond. They warned him that he should get out and get out now. Montigny made an escape plan and got one of his 8 prison guards to pass along messages to the outside helpers. He received coded messages hidden in loaves of bread. The bread also contained a file to cut through the bars of his prison window and a rope ladder so he could climb down. On July 15th, 1568, the day of his escape, his helper guard was running late because of a lady he was in love with. He sent someone else to deliver the bread with the final plan. This man accidentally delivered the bread to the commander of the prison, who found the letter and sounded the alarm. All the Baron's guards were executed and new, stricter ones were put in place. The Baron remained in his tower, awaiting his fate, which was all but sealed. Meanwhile, King Felipe's son Don Carlos, locked in and completely cut off from the outside world, kept threatening that he would kill himself. When his father banned him from having knives or forks in his room, the Infanta tried to starve himself to death. After 15 days, they used a machine to force-feed him soup and pieces of meat. When his confessor finally got him to agree to eat, Don Carlos overate and, in his already weakened state, he got deathly ill. Don Carlos received the sacraments on his deathbed and asked for his father to come and forgive him and bless him. Felipe refused to go. After 6 months of solitary confinement, the Crown Prince died in his room alone, age 23. Immediately, rumors flew that he was given the taste, meaning poisoned, by his own father. And these rumors persisted for centuries as the infamous Leyenda Negra, the Spanish Black Legend. Felipe had written his aunt all about the situation, and this honest and heartbreaking letter was discovered only recently, so now we know what actually happened. Fortunately, Queen Isabella was pregnant again, but after she gave birth to another daughter, she died. Rumors now flew that the king had given her the taste for not giving him more boys. In their 9 years of marriage, Queen Isabella had given him 5 daughters, but only 2 daughters survived past infancy. Isabella Clara Eugenia, remember her, and Catalina Michelle. The king was left with no wife, no heir, and 2 daughters. He had to find a marriage candidate again. Who in his immediate family was left to marry? After the victory of Heiligerlee, Count Lodewijk laid siege on the city of Groningen. The city didn't dare surrender because Alba had ordered Meegen and his soldiers to remain inside the town. Having just lost his brother Adolf, Willem urged his other brother to get the hell out. Lodewijk didn't have enough troops to cut the city off completely, and the area was too poor to sustain his army for very long. Go to Enkhuizen, join the sea beggars, and weaponize the sea. Lodewijk refused to move. Meanwhile, Alba, eager to take on the Nassau brat himself, headed out. By mid-July, the Duke and his commanders converged on Deventer with 17,000 tertios, 3,000 horse, and plenty of cannons. They marched on Groningen, where Alba installed the new stadtholder of Friesland and Groningen, Gaspar de Robles, Señor de Belly. Meanwhile, Lodewijk was dealing with mutinies and other setbacks, and Meegen's troops attacked from the city in so-called sorties, and heavy fights broke out. After a short but brutal fight, Lodewijk lost 600 men and the count knew he was outmatched. He retreated to Jemmingen with over 10,000 men. When Alba heard this, he was thrilled to bits. Lodewijk believed he could make a stand on the peninsula because it could only be reached by a very narrow dike and some bridges. But Alba knew better. The count had trapped himself. Lodewijk ordered the bridges dismantled, the sluice gates opened, and the dikes breached to flood the land for defense. But his mutinous troops weren't exactly in a hurry. They demanded their share of the Heiligerlee loot. On July 21st, at 8 in the morning, only 3 sluices had been opened and 2 bridges were destroyed when they saw the first Spanish regiments. Lodewijk hurried to get his men in battle order. 2 hours later, Alba sent Sancho de Londoño and Julio Romero with 1,500 men ahead to lure the rebels from their trenches. The fight was so fierce that the Spanish commanders pleaded with Alba to send reinforcements 3 times. Each time the Duke said, "Suck it up." The rebels only saw this small portion of the army and nothing else. When scouts confirmed that there was no large force to be seen anywhere, Lodewijk ordered the entire army to move out to overwhelm Londoño's and Romero's troops. This was precisely what Alba hoped the count would do. After only a few hundred yards, the rebels came under heavy gunfire. The reinforcements the Spanish commanders had begged for laid waiting in an ambush. The rebels raced back to camp. Lodewijk tried to encourage the man to stand and fight. It was no use. The moment thousands of tertios flooded the defenses, most rebels threw down their weapons and ran. It was not a battle, but a massacre, and it lasted for days. Alba wanted to make sure the rebels could not regroup and took no prisoners. In the end, 7,000 rebels were killed and only a handful of Spaniards. Lodewijk barely managed to escape by ditching his weapons, armor, clothes, and jumping in the river, buck naked. With the remnants of his troops, he returned to Germany. Thus ended the rebel invasion. Alba smelted the captured rebel cannons into a statue of his awesome self and placed it in Antwerp. The general was now dubbed the Iron Duke. When King Felipe heard about the statue, he was livid. That should have been a statue of his awesome self. On August 31st, 1568, the Prince of Orange issued a formal declaration of war against the Grand Duke of Alba under the motto Pro Lege, Rege et Grege, for the law, for the king, for the people. He addressed it to all the inhabitants of the Netherlands, explaining that the evil Spanish governor general of the king was trying to take over the country and rob them of their ancient freedoms. By the state's constitutions, resistance against intruders was justified when they trampled on their rights and didn't treat them properly. But just so you know, he did not take up arms against the king. On the contrary, the prince was bound by oath to protect the king's interests, which included his people's welfare. Instead, he took up arms against the tyrant, Alba, who was undermining the king's interests and, by extension, his people's welfare. Alba rebelled against the king, not he. On September 7th, 1568, the prince invaded the Netherlands himself.